Adventures of the Ingenious Gentleman Don Quixote de la Mancha by Miguel de Cervantes Saavedra. Adapted for radio in two parts by John Arden. With Bob Grant as Don Quixote, Bernard Cribbins as Sancho Panza, and Ronald Baddiley as Cervantes. Part one.
In a certain village in La Mancha called Argamasilla de Alba... Oh, no, dear, no. In a certain village in La Mancha, of which I do not remember the name... I do not choose to remember the name. God, indeed, I remember it only too well, and I refuse absolutely to exalt that dreary settlement by presenting its crude identity on the very first page of my most notable literary work. My sworn duty to His Majesty, the only possible reason for a fastidious old soldier to debase himself by such a visit. True, the king's dignity overcomes all indignity. True, our Spanish country folk do not relish the king's taxes. True, an old soldier's duty is not always relished by himself. But mother of God... did they need to have thrown me, Miguel de Cervantes Saavedra, into prison?
You bide there, you damned extortioner, till the parish council had a look through your list.
You've over-assessed me by 3 acres of arable and 2 dozen goats.
Yeah, I suppose you're expecting us to bribe you to get let off.
I say to you again, gentlemen, if there are errors in the Revenue Commissioner's assessment, there is a proper procedure of appeal.
No. You can do your own appealing to the mayor when he comes home from El Toboso. In the meantime, you bide here.
Locks, bolts, bars and shutters. The very heart and soul of this damn village. Not half 100 yards away across the street from the graveyard, a gentleman's house all nailed up like a bullpen. The only house of consequence in the whole place, as far as I can see. And the old fellow inside of it, as mad as a hatter. Well, they must keep him confined, lest he do himself an injury. Of course, they can't say that I'm mad. Am I not the government? By definition, the most sane institution in the land. By definition. Except only for Holy Church. By definition. Pope, king, tax gatherer. Oh, we all share the same burden. To impose coercive sanity upon fallible mortal chaos. Which, if true... must imply that those who have put me here must themselves be as mad as their own local madman they've locked up down the street. I had hoped this evening to be at my ease and contemplative. Contemplative of good literature in the courtyard of that very house. In such a residence upon my rounds, I can usually find hospitality. How was I to know the rural fury that would prevail here against my office? Does it matter to them that I'm in debt to my publisher for advance fees upon 6 plays, or failing plays, a full-length novel? Oh, very much failing plays. Lope de Vega, it appears, is now the only man for writing plays. The new school, the advanced techniques. All these years, I've not had leisure to so much as even think about the advancement of technique. Leisure? No, I'm drowned in it. Albeit sufficiently squalid as to the nose, as to the touch. Oof. And unduly productive of crap. Moreover, it is pitch dark. And moreover, I am hereby left absolutely no excuse for an indolent imagination. So what, Miguel de Cervantes Saavedra, potential but unproven the greatest author in all Spain, so what shall you propose to imagine? Well, here we are. A dark room, an old man, well, elderly, past his prime. Not exactly past his prime. Ah, be honest, Miguel. Old, meagre, shriveled, fantastical old man locked up like a naughty child to be chastened in a dark room. So, what can his ill-cultivated, dried-up imagination be expected to create? But just such a story of a meager, shriveled, fantastical old man locked up in a dark room. Apart from this prison, but one gentleman's house in the village, and that house, remarkably, the prison of a madman. Now, I wonder how I... Hello? Who's this?
Hey, tax gatherer, extortioner. You, on your feet. Parish priest wants to see you. Give me a knock, Father, when you're finished.
Oh, dear me. Dear me, dear me. Good evening, Captain.
Good evening.
I did tell them that they shouldn't. But until the mayor arrives, I'm afraid... Well, your accommodation, Captain, not comfortable. I thought perhaps I could alleviate... I am right to call you Captain.
My service with His Majesty's colours was unfortunately terminated when the Moors took me prisoner. I had applied for a commission, but it had not been granted in time. By stretching it a little, I could, I believe, use the courtesy title. But I prefer not.
Oh, you were held by the Moors?
For 5 years, Father. May I say, at no time in quite such unseemly conditions as these.
Oh, dear, yes, I take
it your parishioners have neglected your undoubted instruction of the example of our Lord towards publicans as well as other sinners. Nevertheless, I'm happy to emulate the professional patience of St. Matthew. All in the end will be made clear.
When the mayor returns, I'm sure...
Yes, when the mayor returns... I am going to have quite a lot to say to His Worship, you know.
I can at least see that some respectable food is brought into you from the inn. I'll be glad to keep you company while you eat it. I really am most anxious to hear your adventures among the infidels. Indeed, indeed. The great battle of Lepanto. That glorious victory. The cross against the crescent. And here I am, actually talking to a veritable hero of that day. And disabled, moreover, wielding the sword of Christ in defence of his Catholic people. You see, we hear so much of these valiant deeds of arms, and yet so very few of us can take any credit for them. Oh, we sit here in this barren countryside and quarrel interminably over our flocks and herds, and profit and loss, petty cash, parish pump.
Yet, maybe life or death from that very parish pump, if the season is a dry one.
As at present.
I'm greatly in your debt for this wine.
Oh, some small alleviation. But, as I say, in comparison with the great works of the Spirit in the world of outer darkness, you know, paganism, heresy, the huge new continents beyond the ocean...
I applied for a posting to the Americas, you know. They refused on account of my age.
Oh, but consider the unimaginable wealth brought back from America into the boundaries of Europe. Now, are we a fit people to pretend to be trustees of it? As you have discovered today, to your cost, we are unable to even argue amongst ourselves the disposition of that wealth without childish resort to violence.
I do not defend the precise workings of the Royal Exchequer.
No.
In all probability, the tax assessments are unjust.
Oh. And yet you are a good man. It is your duty to enforce them. If you all of a sudden were to tear up your official documents and refuse on the grounds of conscience to obey your superiors, you would surely be punished. Just as you are now being punished for exactly the reverse.
Oh, I doubt if they would punish me. They declare me non compos mentis and consign me to oblivion. I might even get a pension if my friends made enough fuss about the Battle of Lepanto, my disabled left hand, the cumulative nervous strain after years of captivity, so on and so forth.
Yeah, I suppose they could say that you've been driven mad by a vision of glory. Don Rodrigo Pacheco... One night in his bedroom, had a vision of our Blessed Lady. And they've locked him up ever since.
You mean the house by the graveyard?
Mm. She told him, so he says, that he was her faithful warrior and he must go forth in shining armour and put to death the hordes of Satan. Well, unfortunately, the first demons he pulled out his weapon against were members of the highway police. Well, they referred
the case. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.